Let's conclude this video with an analysis of continuous system. This is where we make the link between structural vibration and acoustics, so between the two different parts of the course. We are going now to analyze continuous system, and I will take one acoustic system, and I will take one dynamic mechanical system. The acoustic system is just a tube filled with air, closed on the far side, and where I have on the other side, on the left side, a piston that is oscillating and creating a sound field inside the duct. And the similar case will be an elastic bar excited along its axis by a shaker. In both cases, I will assume that the system is perfectly one-dimensional. We'll come back on the validity of that assumption, but definitely we consider that the only coordinate along which things are changing is the coordinate of along the axis that I call the x coordinate. Let's start by solving the acoustic case. The sound field in the duct is characterized by a pressure, acoustic pressure spectrum that depends on the position x along the axis and on the pulsation omega. And because it's one-dimensional, I know that, well, first, that the equation is that the second derivative of the pressure spectrum with respect to x plus k squared times the spectrum must be equal to zero. So d2p over dx squared plus k2p is equal to zero. That's the Helmholtz equation in one dimension. And I know that the general solution of that is a pressure field where I have a forward propagating wave, a backward propagating wave. The forward propagating wave has an amplitude p plus that only depends on frequency. The backward propagating wave has an amplitude p minus that also only depends on frequency. And the space dependency is in exponential minus ikx for the forward propagating wave and exponential ikx for the backward propagating wave. Using Euler's equation, and we've seen that before, I can calculate the velocity, so the spectrum of the velocity oscillation in the acoustic fluid, and I know that the velocity in the x direction is obtained by taking I divided by rho omega times the pressure gradient in the x direction, which gives me p plus over rho c exponential minus ikx, minus p minus over rho c exponential plus ikx. With this expression, I will be able to solve the problem, the exact sound field for a given velocity excitation v bar. How do I do that? By expressing the boundary conditions. On the far side, at x equal l, I know that the velocity must be zero. I said that the tube is closed. I assume that closure to be perfect. And so the air molecules cannot get inside that closure. And so the velocity must be zero. And I also know that on the left-hand side, at x equals zero, the velocity of the air particles must be equal to the velocity of the piston because they are in contact with one another. And so I can express that in terms of p plus and p minus. The first condition tells me that p plus minus p minus is equal to rho c v bar, the velocity of the piston. And the second one says that p plus exponential minus ikl minus p minus exponential ikl must be equal to zero. I fully solved that in a separate video. It's not very complicated, but I just do the calculation for you on the blackboard. But this is a system of equation for p plus and p minus that we can solve to obtain their value as a function of rho, c, v bar, omega, and l. And if we put that back into the solution, you see that the pressure in the tube is equal to minus I rho c v bar times cosine k l minus x divided by sine k l. We'll come back to that solution in a second. Now let's consider the one-dimensional bar excited along its axis. There the equation is different. I will not explain where this comes from, but that's really basic strength of material. The Young's modulus E times the second derivative of the displacement u along the x-axis divided by dx squared minus rho, the density of the material d2, the second derivative of u with respect to time, is equal to zero, or in the frequency domain, the second derivative of the displacement spectrum plus omega squared rho divided by e times the displacement spectrum must be equal to zero. And so the general solution is the same as the one we've seen. Now we will have an amplitude u plus and an amplitude u minus for the two waves propagating along the axis. And it's not the velocity that will matter, it's the stress that will matter. And the stress is just e times du over dx, which gives us the expression that are there. And so we have essentially mathematically the same type of expression, and the boundary condition will also be similar because the stress at x equals zero must be equal to the applied force, or the stress times the cross-section must be equal to the force, and the stress at x equals L must be equal to zero because there is nothing to create a stress there because the displacement at the far side is not constrained. And so this again gives us a system of equation for u plus and u minus that we can solve, and we see that the displacement of the bar, the spectrum of the displacement, is f divided by omega, capital omega square root of e times rho times cosine kl minus x divided by sine kl. And these two solutions for the bar and for the tube share a common term, which is cosine kl minus x divided by sine kl. If we look at the denominator, we see that sine kl can be zero for some values of the frequency. Indeed, sine kl is equal to zero when kl is equal to n times pi. And this can be written in two different ways, meaning that sine kl will be equal to zero either when the frequency is an integer number of times c, the speed of sound, divided by twice the length of the tube, or when the length is equal to an integer number of half wavelengths. You can play with the number and with the formula to see that it works. And so we see that these two continuous systems will have an infinite response. So the displacement or the pressure are going to go to infinity if there is no loss, as soon as the frequency have the right value, and n can take any positive or negative value up to infinity. So we indeed have an infinite number, a countable infinite number of resonance frequency in a continuous system. But the numerator is also interesting. Cosine kl minus x will define a certain shape of the displacement, a certain distribution of the displacement in the tube, that are the modes to each resonance frequency corresponds a certain way, a certain distribution of pressure, a certain distribution of displacement in the bar, and which is going to be defined as cosine kl minus x. And you see that for the first frequency, when the length is equal to one half wavelength, well, we have a certain pressure or displacement distribution. We have the second mode corresponds to a length, the length of the bar equal to one full wavelength. The third mode corresponds to three half wavelengths, and so on and so forth. The final thing that I want to say, the truly final thing, is something about standing waves. You know that when you have two waves traveling in opposite direction at the same speed, at the same frequency, with the same amplitude, but just a different phase, they create, each wave is a propagating wave, but the two waves together create what is called a standing wave, where actually the nodes, the point where the pressure or the displacement is zero, are fixed, and we just have oscillation in between the modes. Well, modes in a continuous structure are standing waves, and another way to define the modes is to say that the modes are all the standing waves that may exist in the structure and that are consistent with the boundary condition. To summarize this long video, there are three ways to look at resonances. There are the frequencies at which the response of the system to an excitation is infinite. They are the only frequencies at which a non-zero response can be observed in the absence of excitation. And there are frequencies at which the external force performs no work because of a perfect and total exchange between the potential and kinetic energy. Perfect resonances occur only in conservative systems, yet resonances and modes play an important role in understanding and analyzing dissipative systems. There is one resonance frequency per degree of freedom, single degree of freedom, single resonance frequency, two DOF, two resonance frequencies, n DOF, n resonance frequencies, and for a continuous system, we get an infinite number, a countable infinity of resonance frequencies and modes. A typical response that we call a mode is associated to each resonance frequency. The set of mode forms a basis that is highly suitable for representing the system's response. Mass and stiffness matrices are diagonal when projected in the modal basis. Each mode behaves as an independent single degree of freedom system, and damping partially removes that independence by coupling all modes together. In a continuous system, modes are standing waves, and any standing wave consistent with the boundary condition is a mode. Resonance phenomena are common to a whole range of physical systems, structural dynamics, acoustics, electrical circuits, and everything I've said can be applied to all these disciplines. I realize that's a lot to digest and learn, but this was an attempt to put together different views, different ways to analyze a dynamic system, be they acoustic or dynamics. Thank you for your attention.